wicked witch was so angry when she saw her bees lying in little heaps that she stamped her foot and tore her hair and gnashed her teeth. Then she called a dozen of her slaves, who were the Winkies, and gave them sharp spears. She told them to find the strangers and destroy them. When the lion saw them coming, he gave a great roar. The poor Winkies were so frightened that they ran away as fast as they could. When the Wicked Witch saw what had happened, she made up her mind how to act. She went to the cupboard and took out her golden cap. This cap had a special charm. Whoever owned it could call three times upon the winged monkeys. These creatures would obey any order they were given. The Wicked Witch had used the charm of the cap twice before, so this was her last wish. She put the golden cap on her head and stood on her left foot. Then she recited a secret charm. In a few minutes, the witch was surrounded by a crowd of monkeys with huge and powerful wings on their shoulders. The Wicked Witch ordered the winged monkeys to destroy the strangers, except for the lion. She wanted him brought to her so she could make him her slave.
"Your commands shall be obeyed," said the leader.
Then the winged monkeys flew away. When they found the Tin Man, the monkeys grabbed him and carried him through the air. When they were over some sharp-pointed rocks, they dropped the poor Tin Man. The rest of the monkeys caught the Scarecrow and with their long fingers pulled all of the straw out of his clothes and his head. After they had done this, the monkeys threw pieces of rope around the lion and wound many coils around his body, head, and legs. They lifted him up and flew away with him to the witch's castle. At the castle, he was placed in a small yard with a high iron fence so that he could not escape. But Dorothy was not harmed at all. The leader of the winged monkeys flew up to her. But when he saw the mark of the good witch's kiss on her forehead, he stopped short and motioned the others not to touch her.
"We dare not harm this little girl," he said to them, "for she is protected by the power of good, and that is greater than the power of evil. All we can do is carry her to the castle of the wicked witch and leave her there."
So they carefully lifted Dorothy in their arms and carried her to the castle. The wicked witch was surprised and worried when she saw the mark on Dorothy's forehead. When she saw Dorothy's silver slippers, she began to tremble in fear, for she knew what a powerful charm belonged to them. She said to Dorothy,
"Come with me and see that you mind everything I tell you, for if you do not, I will make an end of you as I did of the Tin Man and the Scarecrow."
The witch led Dorothy through the castle until they came to the kitchen. Here, the witch made Dorothy clean the pots and pans, sweep the floor, and feed the fire with heavy logs. Now the Wicked Witch had a great longing to own Dorothy's silver shoes. She knew the power of these shoes would make her more evil and feared than she already was. The Wicked Witch was very clever, and she finally thought of a trick so that she could get Dorothy's silver shoes. She placed an iron bar in the middle of the kitchen floor. Then she used her magic to make the bar invisible. In this way, she knew Dorothy would trip over the bar and lose her shoes. But when Dorothy tripped over the invisible bar, she only lost one shoe. The witch quickly snatched it and put it on her own foot. When Dorothy saw what had happened, she grew very angry and said, "Give me back my shoe."
"I will not. Now it's my shoe, not yours. And someday I shall get the other one from you, too."
This made Dorothy so angry that she picked up a bucket of water she had been using to wash the floor and threw it over the witch. Instantly, the witch gave a loud scream, and then as Dorothy looked in wonder, the witch began to shrink and melt away.
"See what you've done!"
she screamed.
"In a minute I shall melt away!"
In a few minutes, the witch turned into a brown, melted, shapeless mass and began to spread over the kitchen floor. All that was left of the witch was the silver shoe. Dorothy picked it up, cleaned it, and put it back on her own foot. Then, being free at last, Dorothy ran out to the courtyard to tell the lion that the Wicked Witch of the West had come to an end and that they were no longer prisoners in a strange land. Dorothy gathered all the Winkies together and told them that they were no longer slaves. The Winkies were very happy.
"If only our friends the Scarecrow and the Tin Man were with us," said the lion.
Dorothy and the lion called the Winkies and asked them to help rescue their friends. Now they were united, Dorothy and her friends spent a few happy days at the castle. But after a few days, they all decided that it was time to return to Oz and ask for the things that they had been promised. So they sadly said goodbye to the Winkies and packed food for the journey back to Emerald City. The next morning, Dorothy and her friends began their journey to the Emerald City. They walked a long way and still could not see a sign of the Emerald City. Days passed, and they still saw nothing but the fields and forests. The Scarecrow began to complain.
"We have surely lost our way," he said.
Dorothy sat down on the grass to think. Dorothy used the golden cap to call the winged monkeys, who would carry everyone to the Emerald City. The journey took a very short time. When they reached the gates of the Emerald City, the monkeys set them all down carefully. Then the king bowed to Dorothy and flew swiftly away, followed by all his band. Dorothy and her friends walked up to the gate of the Emerald City and rang the bell. After they rang many times, the guardian of the gate answered the bell. He led them into his little room and gave them all green eyeglasses. Then they passed through the big gates into the Emerald City. When the guardian of the gate told the people that Dorothy had melted the Wicked Witch of the West, they all gathered around the travelers and followed them in a great crowd to the Palace of Oz. Once they reached the palace gates, the soldier greeted them and carried the news of their arrival to the Great Oz. Dorothy thought that once he heard the news, the Great Oz would send for her at once, but he did not. Dorothy and her friends waited for many days. The waiting was tiresome, and at last they grew angry at Oz. So the Scarecrow sent a message to Oz, which said that if he did not see them at once, they would call the winged monkeys to help them and find out whether he kept his promises or not. When the wizard was given this message, he was so frightened that he sent word for them to come to the throne room at 9:04 the next morning. The next morning, the soldier came to escort them to the throne room. The room was empty. They heard a voice that said solemnly,
"I am Oz, the great and terrible. Why do you seek me?"
Dorothy asked, "Where are you?"
"I am everywhere," answered the voice. "If you wish to talk with me, walk near the throne."
So they walked toward the throne, and Dorothy said, "We have come to claim our promises."
"What promises?" asked Oz.
Dorothy repeated the wizard's promise to send her back to Kansas and to give the Tin Man a heart, the Scarecrow brains, and the Lion courage.
"Is the Wicked Witch really destroyed?"
asked the voice. "Yes," answered Dorothy. "I melted her with a bucket of water."
"Dear me," said the voice. "How sudden. Well, come to me tomorrow, for I must have time to think it over."
The Lion thought that he might as well frighten the wizard, so he gave a loud roar. Toto jumped away from him and tipped over a screen. As it fell with a crash, they looked and saw a very strange thing, for standing in just the spot the screen had hidden was a little old man with a bald head and a wrinkled face. The Tin Man shouted,
"Who are you?"
"I am Oz, the great and terrible," said the little man in a trembling voice. "But please don't hit me. I'll do anything you want."
"We thought Oz was a great head, a ball of fire, a terrible beast, or a beautiful woman," said the Scarecrow.
"No, you're wrong," said the little man. "I've been making believe."
"Making believe?" cried the Tin Man. "Are you not a great wizard?" The little man hung his head in shame and confessed that he was only a common man who was able to perform some clever magic tricks. The next morning, the Scarecrow went to see Oz and get his brains. He went to the throne room and knocked at the door.
"Come in," said Oz.
"I have come for my brains," said the Scarecrow.
"I have not forgotten," said Oz, "but I must take your head off in order to put your brains in their proper place."
"That's all right," said the Scarecrow.
So the wizard unfastened the Scarecrow's head and emptied out the straw. Then he went to the back room and mixed a cup of cereal with many pins and needles. He shook the mixture again and again. Then he filled the top of the Scarecrow's head with the mixture and stuffed the rest of the space with straw to hold it all in place. When he fastened the Scarecrow's head back on his body again, Oz said,
"From now on you will be a great man, for you have brains."
The Scarecrow was pleased and proud, and he thanked the wizard again and again.
"I must go to Oz and get my heart," said the Tin Man.
So he walked to the throne room and knocked at the door. Oz welcomed the Tin Man and said he was ready to give him a wonderful heart. He cut a small hole in the left side of the Tin Man's chest. Then he went into the back room and brought out a pretty heart made entirely of silk and stuffed with sawdust. Oz put the heart in the Tin Man's chest and then replaced the square of tin he had removed.
"There,"
he said.
"Now you have a heart that any man would be proud of."
The Tin Man thanked Oz and went back to his friends. Next, it was the Lion's turn to get his courage. He walked to the throne room and knocked at the door.
"Come in,"
said Oz.
"I have come for my courage," announced the Lion.
"Very well,"
said Oz.
"I will get it for you."
He went to a cupboard and took down a small square green bottle. He poured the contents into a green dish. He placed this in front of the lion. The wizard said,
"Drink."
The lion drank until the dish was empty.
"How do you feel now?"
said Oz.
"Full of courage,"
answered the lion. Then he went back to tell his friends of his good fortune. For 3 days, Dorothy did not hear from Oz. This made her sad and worried. After 4 days, Oz sent for Dorothy. When she entered the throne room, he said pleasantly,
"Sit down, my dear. I think I have found a way to get you out of this country."
"And back to Kansas?" she asked.
"Well, not sure about Kansas, but the first thing to do is to cross the desert. And there's only one way to cross the desert. I can make a balloon which will carry us over the desert."
"Us?" cried Dorothy. "Are you going with me?"
"Yes, of course,"
said Oz.
"I'm tired of being such a fake. I don't want my people to discover that I'm not a wizard at all."
The balloon was finally finished. Oz sent word to his people that he was going to make a visit to a great brother wizard who lived in the clouds. Oz ordered the balloon carried out in front of the palace. He got into the basket and said to all the people,
"I'm going away for a while. During that time I am gone, the scarecrow will rule over you. I command you to obey him as you would obey me."
The balloon was beginning to rise into the sky.
"Hurry up, Dorothy," cried the wizard, "or the balloon will fly away."
"I can't find Toto anywhere," answered Dorothy. When Dorothy finally found him, she picked him up and ran toward the balloon. She was only a few steps away when the ropes went crack. The balloon rose into the air without her.
"Come back," shouted Dorothy.
But it was too late. Oz was already riding in the basket, rising farther and farther into the sky. And that was the last any of them saw of Oz. At first, Dorothy was very unhappy about missing her chance to return to Kansas. She cried a lot that first day. But when she thought it all over, she was glad she did not go up in a balloon, although she also felt sorry about losing Oz. The morning after the balloon went up, the four travelers met in the throne room to talk matters over. Dorothy told her friends that although she loved them all very much, she still wanted to return to her home in Kansas. The Scarecrow decided to think. He thought so hard that the pins and needles began to stick out of his brains.
"Let's call in the soldier," he said, "and ask his advice."
When the soldier entered the throne room, the Scarecrow asked him if he knew how Dorothy might cross the desert. The soldier explained that he knew of no one except Oz who had ever crossed the desert.
"Is there no one who can help me?" asked Dorothy. "Perhaps Glinda can help you. She's the Good Witch of the South. She rules over the Quadlings. Her castle stands on the edge of the desert, so she may know a way to cross it."
"How do I get to her castle?" asked Dorothy.
"The road is straight to the south," he answered.
When the soldier left, the Scarecrow said,
"The best thing Dorothy can do is travel to the land of the south and ask Glinda for help."
The Lion, the Tin Man, and the Scarecrow said they would go with Dorothy. The next morning, Dorothy and her friends said goodbye to the Guardian of the Gate and left the Emerald City. They traveled until they came to a forest. The forest was very thick, and there seemed to be no way to go around it, so they looked for the place where it would be easiest to get through the forest. The travelers walked to the edge of the forest. Then, to their surprise, they saw a high wall, which seemed to be made of china.
"What will we do now?" said Dorothy.
"I will make a ladder so we can climb over the wall,"
said the Tin Man. While the Tin Man was making a ladder from wood which he found in the forest, Dorothy lay down and slept. The Lion also curled up to sleep, and Toto lay beside him. After a while, the ladder was finished. The Scarecrow woke Dorothy, Toto, and the Lion. When they were all sitting on top of the wall, they looked down and saw a very strange sight. Before them was a great stretch of land. Scattered around were many houses made entirely of china. There were also tiny barns with china fences around them. There were cows, sheep, horses, and pigs, all made of china. But strangest of all were the people who lived in this unusual country. All these people were made of china. Even their clothes were made of china, and they were so small that the tallest one was no higher than Dorothy's knee.
"How can we get down the other side of the wall?" asked Dorothy.
The ladder was so heavy that they couldn't pull it up, so the Scarecrow fell off the wall. Then the others jumped down on him so the hard floor would not hurt their feet. When they were all safely down, they picked up the Scarecrow and patted his straw back into shape. "We must cross this strange place in order to get to the other side," said Dorothy, "for we really must continue going south." They began walking through the country of the China people. They walked carefully through the China country. Little animals and people scampered out of their way, afraid they would be broken. Soon they reached the other side of the country and came to another high china wall. It was not as high as the first one, and by standing on the lion's back, they all managed to scramble to the top. Then the lion gathered his legs under him and jumped the wall. Before them lay a gloomy forest. The four travelers passed through the forest safely. When they came to the edge of the forest, they saw a steep hill, covered from top to bottom with large pieces of rock.
"This will be a difficult climb," said the Scarecrow, "but we must get over this hill."
The country of the Quadlings was rich and happy. The fields were full of wheat, and there were pretty rippling brooks and well-paved roads. The houses were all painted bright red. The Quadlings were short and fat. They dressed all in red. They went up to a farmhouse and knocked on the door. Dorothy asked for something to eat. The woman gave them all a good dinner. "How far is it to the castle of Glinda?" asked Dorothy.
"It is not far," answered the farmer. "Take the road to the south and you will find it."
They thanked the woman and walked until they saw a very beautiful castle. Dorothy and the others were admitted to the castle at once. Before they went to see Glinda, they were taken to a room where they were washed and fixed themselves up. When they were all presentable, they went into a big room where the witch Glinda sat upon a throne of rubies. She was a beautiful witch.
"What can I do for you, my child?" she asked.
Dorothy told the witch her long story. "My greatest wish now," she added, "is to get back to Kansas."
"Bless you, dear heart," she said. "I'm sure I can tell you how to return to Kansas, but if I do, you must give me the golden cap."
"Of course," said Dorothy. Glinda smiled, and Dorothy handed her the golden cap. "You certainly are as good as you are beautiful, but you have not yet told me how to get back to Kansas."
"Your silver shoes will carry you over the desert," answered Glinda. "If you had only known their power, you could have gone back to your Aunt Em the very first day you came to this country. All you have to do is knock your heels together 3 times and command the shoes to carry you wherever you wish to go."
"If that is so," said Dorothy, "I will ask them to carry me back to Kansas." She kissed the lion, the tin man, and the scarecrow goodbye. They all cried and hugged her tightly. Then Dorothy took Toto in her arms, said one last goodbye to her friends, and clapped the heels of her shoes together 3 times and said, "Take me home to Kansas." In a few seconds, she was whirling through the air. Aunt Em had just come out of the house to water the cabbages when she looked up and saw Dorothy running toward her.
"My darling child," she cried, "where in the world did you come from?"
"From the land of Oz," said Dorothy, "and here's Toto too. And Aunt Em, I'm so happy to be home again."